This is a production of WKNO Memphis. Production funding for Behind the Headlines is made possible in part by the WKNO Production Fund, the WKNO Endowment Fund, and by viewers like you. Thank you.
The county debates tax rates, school funding, and more tonight on Behind the Headlines. I'm Eric Barnes, publisher of the Memphis Daily News. Thanks for joining us. We're joined tonight by two county commissioners. First, Steve Mulroy, County Commission. Thanks for being here.
Thank you.
Also, Steve Baser, the County Commission. Thank you for being here. And Harvey Kennedy, Chief Administrative Officer for Shelby County Government. Thanks for being here.
Thank you, Eric.
Let's talk. You guys are in budget season, kind of going towards the end, and there's a debate right now over tax rate. By comparison maybe to the city, which is a show we did last week, the debate is not as heated or heavy. But I'll start with you, Steve Mulroy. What plans are on the table right now? What is up for discussion in terms of the tax rate and where that money would go?
Eric, there are two competing tax rates right now. One proposed by the administration would give a 1 cent tax cut to all Shelby Countyans, plus an additional 4 cent on the property tax rate tax cut just for those citizens who live outside of Memphis. That one happens to be sponsored by Commissioner Schaefer. The competing tax rate, which is sponsored by me, would give that 1 cent tax cut to all Shelby Countyans, but would not give any selective tax cut to just one portion of Shelby County. Instead, the additional $2.8 million of annual revenue for the next 4 years that represents would be used to provide pre-K funding, to expand pre-K instruction in Shelby County, probably another 500 or 600 children who otherwise wouldn't get pre-K instruction, pre-kindergarten instruction, would get the opportunity for early childhood education.
Okay, and your take on the competing proposals and where things are going?
Well, I think the important thing, Eric, is that we're looking at a reduction in tax rate no matter which proposal we go with. So right. That's very encouraging. I'm inclined to go with the administration's policy in terms of going to one tax rate for the whole county and eliminating that second tax. And so we'll have one rate for the whole county, and it's a good step in the right direction in terms of reducing taxes.
And the administration's point of view, why put that forward?
Well, it was important for the administration. We felt like that when the rural school bond tax rate, the additional 4 cents for residents that lived outside the city of Memphis, was implemented back to pay off the rural school bonds that were issued to build Arlington High School, it probably made sense back in 2003. But with all the changes that have come about with the school system, with the merger of the city and county schools, and then the demerger, if you will, into the municipal school districts, we don't think that the dual tax rate makes any sense anymore. And it was important to for us to find an alternative source of funds to pay off those rural school bonds, and we've done that. So there's really no need to continue the dual tax rate. The administration believes that that's divisive for the community. We need a single tax rate, and that's what we proposed and very strongly support the administration's version of the tax rate.
You know, does that hit you in some ways? I mean, Steve, the idea of a dual tax rate, I mean, we have gone through this tumultuous merger, demerger. I mean, it's been, you know, before that even a fight over consolidated government, it's been extremely divisive. And is this sort of this legacy that there's a two-tiered tax rate that at some point needs to be righted, that we're all Shelby County residents, we all fund the schools, we all pay the same tax rate?
Eric, it will be righted in 2018 when the rural school bonds are paid off. That was always the deal. And I think it's important for us to understand how we got to this point. Mr. Kennedy mentioned it briefly, but didn't really go into a lot of detail. Back in 2003, a deal was struck between the then suburban school district and the Memphis school district and the county commissioners from those areas.
Yeah.
Ordinarily, if you had spent $30 million to construct Arlington High School, which is what they were trying to do, under the state's ADA formula for proportionate funding, you would have had to put in an additional $70 million for the Memphis City School System. It was based on the membership of the student populations. Well, no one wanted to spend a total of $100 million, so the deal that was struck was the Memphis City School System would give up its $70 million that it was legally entitled to. In exchange, the bonds for Arlington High School would have to be paid only by those taxpayers outside the Memphis City system area. Now, if you want to unwind that deal 10 years down the road, if you want to stop that deal 4 years early, well, then what's good for the goose is good for the gander. You've got to give Memphis City Schools its share of the $70 million in ADA funds that it gave up. And that would be about $25 million.
Right.
No one wants to do that. Everyone's saying, kumbaya, let's level the tax rates. But they're not doing the other side of the bargain. They're not giving what is now the Shelby County school system the ADA money that it gave up.
Steve Baser, your take on that?
Well, you know, I think so much has changed. We've had a merging of the school systems. We've had a demerging of the school systems. And now we've got seven municipal schools. And so the landscape has changed dramatically from what it was when that deal was initially struck. You've also got new commissioners, and even the boundaries of the city have changed. So you've got places that were in the county that are no longer having to pay that rural bond tax because now they're part of the city of Memphis. So I think what we're trying to do is just level the playing field, have one tax rate for everybody, and then we can move forward on reducing taxes, you know, in subsequent years.
Eric, sure. If I could, notice what we're saying, though. We're saying the situation has changed, so we need to stop having the extra 4 cents to pay off the school bonds. So we're going to have to unwind that part of the deal. But no one says that the change situation means we unwind the other part of the deal and give the now existing county school system the $25 million that they're due. I'd also like to point out that in business and in law, when you have a merger, that doesn't magically wipe away all debts and pre-existing obligations. And that didn't happen here. It didn't happen when we had the merger. There was no negotiated change of this deal. It didn't happen when we settled the federal school litigation. There was no negotiated change in this deal. My colleagues on the other side of the aisle are always talking about how county government should be run like a business. Well, if you use that analogy, then this debt stands. And if you decide to undo it, then you need to undo both sides of the deal and give the Memphis City Schools, now the Shelby County Schools, the $25 million it's due.
But there is no Memphis City Schools. There's the Shelby County Schools, and now, as Commissioner Baser mentioned, we're going to have a multitude of municipal schools. It's just a completely different landscape. To try to maintain the deal, again, that's back to the divisiveness of the issue. That's exactly why the administration wanted to eliminate the 4 cents, get rid of the dual tax rate. It continues to be a divisive issue between the suburbanites and the citizens of Memphis.
And was another recent divisive issue on the schools and the funding was that the legacy Shelby, I don't know what you want to call it, the Shelby County schools, the city schools got a really what some people in the suburbs thought was an unfair chunk of capital spending this year. I mean, it was some almost $50 million or something. And I think the administration put forward that maybe something closer to $17 million or $20 million would go to the legacy city schools. I mean, is that part of the subtext in this? I mean, that sense of divisiveness and who's getting their fair share of the pie?
Well, always we were planning to make sure that there was an equitable distribution of the capital funds, just like there will be the operating funds going forward. We wanted to make sure that those just initiated municipal schools would get a fair share of the capital spending. Our proposal for about $15 million of capital funds really had more to do with the fact that we're right at the end of the fiscal year. We wanted to fund the new school that everyone seemed to think that was certain, a couple of important projects that had been on the books for a long time, and then consider the rest of those capital projects moving forward into the fiscal year that will start next July.
Was that additional capital funds going to the legacy city schools, was that just the inverse of what you're talking about here, an unfair treatment to the suburban schools in favor of the city schools?
Actually, the final version that was passed had a fairly substantial capital outlay for the municipal school districts as well, a roughly proportional to what you would expect given the student populations. So there wasn't really any unfair funding. There was originally a request from the current SCS, which the county commission was inclined to adopt, but then Commissioner Ritz amended it on the floor, and we gave some money to the municipal school districts as well. So it's been fair. And then just quickly, on this point of divisiveness, what really seems divisive, I think, Eric, is this notion is that we take money from the general fund that could be spent for any purpose. It could be spent to hire deputies. It could be spent to cut taxes for all Shelby Countyans. It could be spent, as I think it should be, to help with pre-K. And instead, what we do with it is we subsidize a tax cut only for those people outside Memphis. That's divisive.
What was your take on the capital spending and the way that played out? Would you have liked to have seen more money go to the municipal schools in that in the way that was put forward?
Eric, I think the important thing is we need to approach it from a standpoint of need. And we've got older schools in the legacy, you know, Memphis City schools than we do out in the county. And so in terms of capital expenditures and trying to make sure that the facilities are proper, you know, the schools might need more. The legacy Memphis City schools or now the Shelby County schools might need more capital than the suburbs. So, you know, we need, and that's one of the things that we're looking at doing is having a study done on all facilities to understand what the needs are and prioritize them, because we need to be in alignment on that.
But in that school's facility study that you're referencing, that failed at the June 16th meeting, is that correct? And I should point out that we're taping the show a week ahead, so there's a bit of a time lag here. You all are meeting again before the show airs.
But that doesn't mean that it can't come back, and it doesn't mean that it won't pass.
Right, and the facility study was what? Was exactly what you're talking about, is trying to get your arms around all these schools that are now under the umbrella
of... Every school is going to get inspected, we're going to look at it, we're going to understand how the roofs are, what the HVAC looks like, how the windows are, and what are the needs for each individual, and then prioritize them across the whole spectrum so that we're spending money efficiently. That's the most important thing in my mind. And so, you know, we're just kind of, you know, there was money available in the budget, and the schools came with a plan to say, you know, I need money for these things. And they sort of backed into the number, if you will. They said, okay, I think we got about $50 million in the budget, so let's come up with $50 million to spend. Now, was that the best spend of $50 million? I don't know. I have to assume that they did the due diligence to say this is how we ought to spend the $50 million.
There is some reason to think, though, that there's far more than $50 million. There's hundreds of millions of dollars in deferred maintenance in the legacy SCS system that we haven't been addressing for a long time. So there is a backed-up need. So I think the expenditure that we did recently was justified. But I do agree with Commissioner Baser that a study of some sort going forward is useful. There's some minor dust-up right now about whether it should be done by the administration or by the school system itself and to what extent the municipal school districts will be included. That'll be worked out, and in the next meeting, July 7th, that study will be funded.
And your take on, I mean, I get confused, and I cover this stuff pretty closely, but as we've evolved in this, your take and the administration's responsibility for all the schools, it starts and ends where? Because the funding, a huge amount of funding for all the schools, runs through the county.
That's
correct. But all those school systems have their own independent superintendents and boards. What is the administration's role in terms of holding the various school systems accountable, assessing where the money should go? Where does your responsibility begin and end?
Well, our responsibility is a little bit more concentrated, if you will, in the county schools, where we are the funding source for operational funding and capital funding for all of the municipal schools. That funding will be based on the student population, a prorated amount. The capital budget for the county schools, though, is actually a part of the county's capital spending program. Our control, if you will, or our involvement with the municipal schools is going to be slightly different. It's going to be a little bit more like it was with the Memphis City schools when that system existed, in that we will allocate funding to them, on a student population basis, and then they will be accountable to their own municipal governments for the balance of capital funding and for the approval of their budgets. We'll essentially fund them, but without the same kind of control or oversight that we have for the county schools.
Because the county schools, which are the Memphis City schools on some level, There's no municipality in between.
That's correct. Okay. They are the county schools, and they report directly to the county commission for funding.
Okay.
And we have a great deal more input and control over that budget than we do the municipal schools' budgets.
And so in Collierville, you've got the county, and then you've got the city of Collierville, and then you've got a county school board, and then you've got the schools themselves. Is that a fair...
Well, Collierville has its own school board,
right,
and then they get funding from the city of Collierville,
right,
along with the prorated share of funding that the county provides to them, both for operations and capital.
Simplicity itself.
Simplicity itself, yes, all right. And I just want to spell it out every once in a while because we are pretty close to this, but the facility study, do you all want to run that?
We proposed a facility study that the county would pay for out of surplus funds that we have in the current fiscal year. We thought if we ran it through the county's public works director, a very seasoned, skilled individual working closely with the Shelby County schools, and our plan was to offer the facilities review to the municipal schools as well, since they took possession of their buildings on June 1st. If they declined, well, that would be fine, but we would offer the facilities review for everyone to get the prioritized listing of requirements.
Okay, and switching also, Steve Mulroy mentioned pre-K and funding that. What is the administration's point of view on funding pre-K?
The administration, like everyone, we're firm believers that the expanded pre-K is essential for this community. We're not really in favor of just adding $2.8 million to the school budget for several reasons. We've got a maintenance of effort issue that come into play. We've got an ADA issue, a distribution to the municipalities that comes into play. But more importantly, we don't really have a good plan. And we're going to propose a different plan to perhaps set aside some funding in a different fashion during fiscal 15 and perhaps bring a plan back to the commission sometime around the first of the year, working with a number of the stakeholders, including representatives from our county commission.
I saw you shaking your head.
Really important clarification.
Yeah, sure.
There's a state law that specifically says that outlays that are directed towards pre-K will not affect the maintenance of effort requirement that Ms. Coney just referred to. Now, there's a lot of inside baseball here, but maintenance effort basically
we're that sort of show.
Yeah. It's a state law requirement that says that if you give an extra $3 million to the school system this year, then it's a one-way ratchet. You have to maintain that same level of funding in every subsequent year, right? And that kind of ties our hands a little bit. That doesn't apply with this pre-K funding. So I just wanted to make sure that was clear.
Okay.
But they're not obligated to use it for pre-K funding if you just increase the school's budget.
So there's some discretion there.
So you write a check to the school system
for $3 million.
You just add into their allocation, then that it does become a part of the maintenance of effort.
We can set up other mechanisms to get the funding to the pre-K, and that's something that we're going to be probably looking at in the future.
But there are a couple of important things
in terms of the schools, and one of the reasons why, you know, we all support pre-K, and I think we're going to eventually have universal pre-K in this community.
Yeah.
But right now, the city, the Shelby County schools are dealing with the demerger.
Right.
They're also picking up Head Start, and that's something that, you know, we haven't talked about. So they've got a lot on their plate, and so I think in the spirit of, you know, you've got a lot on your plate, let's get through this year, this budget cycle. We've got a facilities review to do as well, and then we can look at what do we do with pre-K, because we're going to be looking at pre-K and Head Start together. And I think that's important, is what do we do with pre-K and Head Start all under one umbrella, and what's the best thing for the whole community?
You were going to say.
Just two quick things.
Sure.
Honestly, this question about we don't know what the money's really going to go towards pre-K, yes, we do. Dorsey Hobson, the superintendent of schools, has sent us a letter saying that if you give us this allocation, he promises that it'll be used for pre-K and only pre-K for the next few years as long as we give that outlay. The school board has already discussed that, and they have already authorized Mr. Hobson to say that. So unless you're willing to call Mr. Hobson and the school board a liar, we do know that the money's going for pre-K and only pre-K. So that's not really an issue. As to this other question about whether we should wait and just do it at some unspecified time down the road, I have been hearing this for years. I've been on the county commission for 8 years. We've been talking about pre-K for the last 4 or 5 years. Everyone's always got good reasons why we should increase funding for pre-K at some undefined time in the future, never now. In the meantime, generation after generation of children are going through the system not prepared for kindergarten. We already have statistics that say that 2 out of 3 children that come into kindergarten are not grade level ready. We have an existing structure right now of pre-K that works. No one says it doesn't. The schools work pre-K classrooms. They do a fine job of it. It's just a question of asking them to ramp up. We can do that this year with $2.8 million that's otherwise unspent. It's right. It can be used for any purpose. I say use it for that and not to subsidize a tax cut for the suburbanites.
And is your concern just that accountability, that if you write the blank check to the Shelby County schools, that, I mean, I assume you're not going to sit here and call Dorsey Hobson a
Certainly
liar.
Certainly not.
But
no,
there's a,
yeah,
right.
Yeah,
but there's,
that's
there's
ludicrous.
Still,
the,
yeah, no, but I assume there's concern about accountability.
Those decisions, you know, certainly they could step up, and I'm sure that they would mean it. I'm sure that they would agree with it. But as Commissioner Baser pointed out, there's an awful lot on the plate. The Head Start program, a $25 million federally funded program that handles 3,200 kids is at a maximum, is something that's brand new to the county schools. They're going to administer it. They've just recently put out an RFP to subcontract the services. As Commissioner Baser pointed out, there's an awful lot on their plate. I realize that they would take the money if we gave it to them. But, you know, again, prioritizing, we believe it's more important to stabilize the tax rate countywide.
$2.8 million would pay for roughly how many kids?
I think about 20 classrooms. More like, is the number that was talked about.
I would think more like 25 classrooms.
Okay, 20,
we're talking 20, about
25,
500, some 500 some children.
What's some the overall, number. I mean, I'm putting you guys on the spot, what's the overall need for pre-K? I mean, we still must be really short of the overall, I mean.
Absolutely.
Yeah, right.
We're nowhere near filling the need.
Right, and how, you know, you're newer on the commission.
Yes. To
Steve's point that it's talked about, like you said, everyone agrees about it, but yeah, it doesn't get done. Well, what does it take to get it done?
Well, first of all, it's one of the moon missions of the Chamber of Commerce. It is to say, we want universal pre-K.
Right.
And I think you've got an administration that's saying, you know, that's something we want to move to. You've got a commissioner here that's saying that's something we want to move to. So I feel confident that over the next 4 years, you're going to see a lot of movement towards that.
Right.
Part of it is we got to figure out what is, you know, how big is the pie that we need to do.
Okay.
To your point, how many kids are unserved? Because you've got kids who have pre-K, you know, private pay pre-K. And then
right,
you've got kids who are in pre-K now, and you've got kids who are in Head Start. So there's a bucket of people that aren't being served in pre-K. And how many of them, you know, how many of them would do it if it was available? You know, and what would it cost?
Okay. All right. We've got maybe 5 minutes, 6 minutes left in the show here. You talked about taxes, and, it, you know, there's possibly a penny or two or three, you know, maybe in certain areas, 4 cents. Is there a will to lower the tax rate even more dramatically, though? I mean, we've had people on the show lately, just because it's budget season, talking, comparing the tax rate for Shelby County, you know, Memphis and Shelby County, and so on, to Nashville, Knoxville, Chattanooga. And
yeah,
when you look at just the tax rates, it's higher. The combined rate, county and city, for city of Memphis, for, I think, Germantown, it's higher. It's just really one of the highest in
Absolutely,
the state.
Absolutely, it's one of the highest in the state.
Do you see a road where tax rates fall, or is that just not possible in this day and age?
I think we're making a first important step here to make a penny for the city
right,
and 5 cents for outside the city. And then moving forward, I think every year you're going to see a 4 to 6 cent reduction. At least that's my goal, is to have 4 to 6 cents reduction
right,
per year for the next 4 years.
Right.
And
right,
then, you know, you're not going to, it wouldn't be prudent to go chop 30 cents off the rate next year and then slash county spending. But what is more prudent is to take an incremental approach.
Right. You're coming to the end of 8 years,
right,
is that correct?
That's correct.
On taxes, are they too high? They've gone up, it's not your fault, or maybe it is your fault, maybe mm-hmm, you claim credit for that, but it's mm-hmm, gone up in the last 8 years, in part response to lower property values, I think a lot of people would say. How hard is it, as you look back, to cut taxes? How important is it to cut taxes?
Taxes are too high. We're the highest tax rate of any county in the state, and that needs to change. We actually, during my 8 years, we never actually increased taxes. We actually decreased taxes one or two times until last year, when Mayor Lutchell proposed a significant tax increase to take care of school funding needs, which I supported.
Yeah.
I will say this. One of the reasons that we have the highest tax rate in the state is not just that we're spendthrifts. We have a disproportionate amount of poverty and need in this particular community. It's a structural problem that we've had for
yeah,
a long time, so it means the need for services is greater and the ability of people to pay is lower. That and the fact that we've got this patchwork quilt system of a county government and a city government, all these municipal governments, if we had consolidated like Davidson County had done back in the 60s, we would have had a much
yeah,
lower
that,
tax rate.
Yeah, and that's a point that people will make.
But
the people,
point.
And we had people from the city on last week talking mm-hmm, about, I mean, you've got a blended, up in Nashville, your Germantown and Collierville equivalents are combined in the taxes with, from front to back, the whole thing. And
right,
it does change the tax rate. The other thing about Nashville, the comparison is, the homes are, I mean, careful what you wish for, the homes are so much more expensive.
Yes.
And our paper in Nashville just did a story on people being priced out of Nashville. I
right,
mean, it's just too expensive.
Yeah,
but
well, the one thing, too, that we're missing here is the fact that the tax base, in some respects, has been shifting. You know, the growth in DeSoto County did not happen by accident.
Yeah.
People left Memphis. People left Shelby County. People are leaving Shelby County all the time. We need to stop that from happening.
Right.
You know, we're not going to address the tax rate until we can address getting people to come back and getting people to stay here.
But it's a chicken and egg thing, right? I mean, from one point of view.
Because what happens
is people go,
the tax base leaves, and then that leaves
yeah,
a greater burden on everybody else.
Right.
And
right,
so we need a bigger, we need more people to come to Memphis and Shelby County.
Right.
And we need to increase the tax base.
Your take on taxes yeah, and the direction of the county.
We're clearly going to be trying to continually mm-hmm, lower the tax rate. Commissioner Baser, I hope he's right. I hope we can lower them 4 to 6 cents, but I'm not so sure that we can move them quite that quickly. But what we're counting on, and I think if we will stick to the county's fairly rigorous debt plan, mm-hmm, capital spending, we continue to to reduce debt, and we can continue to take pennies off the tax rate by reducing the debt service payment, which doesn't provide services. It doesn't pay for anything except the borrowed money.
That's
and
true.
If we can continue to do that, maintain, continue to bring debt down, as we have from a high of $1.8 billion back in 2006 down to under $1.3 billion at the end of this fiscal year, we can substantially reduce those annual payments, and then we can try to give some of that back to the taxpayers and take care of some of the inflation that goes on in the rest of the government.
Just a minute and a half left. In the city right now, there's a huge debate, huge changes in the way benefits, pensions are on deck next. They've just changed, dramatic changes to the health insurance. The county went through this some years ago, right? Major
changes. We've made multiple changes. We've implemented a new pension plan, but I might add that one of the cost of county government is we fully fund pension and we fully fund the retiree benefits program.
But reduce those benefits but some years ago. What was the reaction? I mean, if you could give advice to the city of Memphis on what this is going to mean and the reactions, you don't have to. It's just free advice. What would your advice to be dealing with it? I mean, it's got to be disheartening if you're an employee and suddenly your benefits change dramatically.
Absolutely.
It might be the best thing to do, but it's still disheartening.
I sympathize with city. It's unfortunate that they underfunded the plans. They underfunded the pension and the post-employment benefits, but they've got to get those funds solid. The state's going to force it. Taking some of the draconian cuts that they're looking at now, I think, are absolutely essential. I don't know how they can do it otherwise.
All right. Well, that's all the time we have. Thank you for being here,
Thank
Steve
you,
Mulroy.
Eric.
Thank you for being here, Steve.
Thank you.
Thank you for being here. Thank you for joining us. Join us again next week. Good night.